sixth week.
Oh my God. Don't say that. You're scaring us.
Okay.
So today the goal of this is to run through kind of a complete case study, get you guys used to thinking about kind of the entire process, so to speak. It's obviously going to be an abbreviated entire process relative to what you would do in practice. But hopefully it'll give you a good start on that. So, any questions before I get going now? You're laughing.
I'm laughing with you.
You're laughing with me? Expecting to believe that?
Maybe. Okay. It's Monday.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Everybody got my email before I get going, right? On the change of threshold. Yeah, I'm here, guys. It's third threshold. Sorry about that. Again, it would be fairly uninteresting if I left the 300 or whatever I had. Okay, variability.
You should just assume that I'm. Mondays, if you're handing out a lecture, you don't need to print as many. Wednesdays, you can print more.
Yeah, is that the way it works?
Yes, too.
Letting me in on something there? Okay. So, then in that case, let's get going. So, last lecture, what I did was focus completely on exploratory data analysis, primarily for the variance covariance structures. Okay. We looked at multiple diagnostics there, so some of them you might consider. Would be things like spaghetti plots, which you guys are looking at in homework right now. You might look at empirical variance or covariance matrices. In other words, divide your data up either by space or time, try and borrow information off of individuals or observations, and look at pairwise correlations between individuals at that point, right? All that relied upon mean center responses, so residuals. And then I also looked at a variogram, which helped us to kind of diagnose what I would consider to be kind of the three main attributes you would think about in correlation for longitudinal spatial data. So you've got the concept of a random intercept. Do some clusters tend to just have values that are higher or lower than others? They kind of exist always. Then you've got this concept of a serial process that says measurements closer in time or space should be more highly correlated with one another than measurements taken farther out in time or space. And then finally, this concept of measurement error. They start shrinking in time and considering the correlation between two measurements at the same time. Does that go to one, or is there existing measurement error that's inside of the process that I need to account for? Okay, so that was really what the variogram got us. That was that kind of rather abstract Dickel model that I had written down in class. Okay, so today we're going to still focus on the max data analysis, but we're going to kind of constrain the analysis, because one of the things I brought up there was you had this kind of this oddity in the data set when you're looking at correlation through time and kind of marginalizing across individuals, in that different individuals were zero converting at different times. Okay, so there really wasn't a well-defined origin, so to speak. So we're going to kind of refine the question a little bit today by focusing on 307 of the men who were HIV negative at study start. That was not necessarily the case for you guys previously. Some of those individuals came into that study, they were already zero converted. You can see where they start times. You know, some of them would have been positive. And so now we're going to start with the time origin, or anchor ourselves to the time of zero conversion. And really the question that we want to address here is whether the baseline viral load, you can think about that as dose of the disease almost, you know, it's kind of an abusive term, but you can think about it that way, or severity of disease at time of conversion, is related to the decline of CD4 counts after zero conversion. So the idea is thinking that if you have a higher viral load count, your CD4s might become depleted quicker in time, right? So as you're thinking about treating the disease, you want to know if there are more severe patients versus less severe patients in terms of their viral load counts. that's the underlying premise here. We're looking at this particular question. Good, so I'm gonna break over into R, and I'm gonna be there primarily for a lot of this. So let's do some basic descriptives first, and then we'll jump into some EVA for the covariance again from last time. So let's just get an understanding of the data themselves. So if you look at the data, I've got kind of the code book here. You can also find it online for yourselves. So you've got months since zero conversion. That's going to be one of our predictors of interest. And we'll write down that mean model in just a second. We've got age, CD4 and CD8 counts. We're gonna focus primarily on CD4 counts. These are the T helper cells. CD8 counts are suppressor cells. Baseline viral load is, again, the viral load for the subject at the time of seroconversion, so at baseline in study. An AIDS case is if, one, if AIDS was not observed, two, if AIDS was observed, three, if they died prior to AIDS actually occurring. So you have HIV infection, but not necessarily full-blown AIDS in this study. B time is just calendar time for the visit that came through. Everything has been standard back to us for time the last week of. And then there's an indicator in here of that. This is going to come up a little bit later, though, relative to the things that you guys are looking at on homework right now. One of the things I'm having you guys look at on homework right now is to say simulate longitudinal data, where you've got these trajectories over time, but then once you get to a certain threshold, the subject goes missing, so to speak. Right? Do you see the potential relevance here? CD4 counts are kind of depleting over time. Subjects may pass away due to infection and inability to fight off of infection, so therefore you no longer see any CD4 counts remaining on that particular individual. Okay, so it's an exact analogy to the type of data that you're simulating in homework right now. You're gonna look at what the impact of that missingness is in homework. Okay? And note that I call that in homework a missing at random data scheme. Why? It's explained by one of the covariates, and in particular, it's explained by the response, right? I mean, you have a model for the response, and your missingness is completely determined by when that response comes down past the particular threshold. 450 was what I ended up giving you as a correction there. And so it is a missing at random scheme. A lot of people don't tend to think about it that way because they think about missing at random being the predictors, right? But it's missing at random. It's dependent upon some observed covariate. That covariate happens to be the response of interest. Yeah. All right. So you might be thinking, if you were analyzing these data, and that's why I have death actually inside of this data set, you might be thinking that, well, if something is happening to where you're truncating off CD4 counts over a particular period of time due to, say, censoring from death, then that should induce this kind of missing at random scheme as well. And again, we'll talk tomorrow about what you guys learned of the impact of that. Okay. So I'm going to jump over to R. You guys have notes in front of you. If you have computers, you can follow along. So first of all, let's read this guy in. That's just my name. So for right now, I'm just going to keep a simplified version of this data set. Okay. So I'm only going to keep the ID for the subject, the months since zero conversion that the measurements were made, the CD4 measurements that were made, and then the viral load at baseline. So if we just look at the head of this data set, it's a very simple data set. Subject ID 1022, these are the months that they're measured on. These are the CD4 counts as they're going along, and this is the viral load that they had actually begun with. So that's going to be, so what type of variable or covariate is this? What we would either describe as time invariant or cluster specific. Okay, in other words, it doesn't change within the cluster. And so again, when you hear people talk about this, that's what it means. Okay, and that has relevance in terms of what the impact is in terms of changes in variances. Okay, due to correlation within versus between clusters, as we have looked at. Okay. Month is obviously a time varying covariate, right? So it's varying inside of the cluster. Okay. So just a couple of other things that I'm going to do to make this analysis easier, just so that we can walk through and I can focus on the parts that I want to focus on, is I'm going to eliminate any individuals for which there is a missing baseline viral load in my study. That's my predictor of interest here. Okay, so I'm going to focus on those individuals that have a baseline viral load. If I were doing this in practice and I were doing an analysis, I would spend a lot of time thinking about what are the characteristics of those individuals that are missing baseline viral load versus those that aren't missing baseline viral load. I might do some multiple mutation sensitivity analysis on the baseline viral load. Okay, so I'm not advising that this is the one strategy that you do. You just go to na.omit and forget everything about it. That's not what I'm saying. It's pedagogical, so I can get through this in an hour. Okay, so I'm just going to pull them out to make life a little bit easier. I don't want you guys on your qualifying exam saying Dylan just says use na.omit on any data set that you have. That's the key point here, right? Okay, so now let's look a little bit at the frequency of subjects that we have. Again, if you're doing any kind of repeated measures data analysis, you want to have something along these lines, right? Tell me how many observations that I have on different individuals. Or similarly or analogously, how many individuals do I have with a particular amount of observations? So the underlying goal here is to model the change in CD4 counts over time. So we're going to be estimating slopes of individuals with CD4 counts over time. So as I've pointed out in the past, these 13 individuals that are sitting here aren't giving us a whole lot of information on their within individual slopes, okay, as a function of time. So I'm going to start to focus my analysis on these folks that are 3 to 9 measures. Okay, that's what I've got data on. Again, if I were looking at this in practice, I would start examining, are these individuals different in some way? Did both of them pass away due to very low, for example, viral load, or high viral load counts, low CD4 counts at their first or second visits, things like that. Those are natural questions to be asking. For now, though, I'm going to take a simplified approach just for here to truncate things and just focus on those individuals with 3 or more measurements. Yeah?
Is that the first, like, remove the missing data there, is to remove the subjects or remove the objects?
So I'm actually removing all subjects that would have a missing viral load when I do that. Because what would happen is if they have a missing viral load at baseline, all of their values are going to be missing. So I'm going to take out the entire subject. That means it's going to be cluster specific. Okay, so now, once I pull those 13 individuals up, so that's all I'm doing with this drop here. Those are just the individuals that I'm pulling off. And then I'm just going to come back and then reset my data set. So at the end of the day, now once I have start focusing on patients that I have complete data on, what I mean by that is baseline viral load counts, as well as 3 or more measurements of CD4 over time, I'm now left with 213 patients from the 309 that I had begun with. So those 213 patients then contribute a total of 1,457 unique observations into my analysis, in other words, CD4. So the only last thing that I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a variable so I can track this a little bit easier in the future, or something called observation, which is just an observation number. So that's all I'm doing with this guy. So now again, if I look at the head of my data set, all I've done is said, okay, this is observation 1 for person 10, 22, and observation 2, observation 3. There's a lot more, by the way, efficient ways of doing that than I just kind of wrote it out for you so you can see what I'm doing. Okay. So far, so good. We all right? Okay. So now, for the viral load status, I will pull off my viral loads at time 0. And then let's look at a histogram of these guys really quickly. What do we think of that? So we've got some individuals with viral loads of like 1.4 million. We've got some individuals with viral loads of like 500. Okay. So it's highly skewed, obviously. Okay. So the way that people have come to think about viral loads now is to think about them more on the log scale because of this. They might sink in those kind of outliers that are sitting way out there. And so that's actually what we're going to do in our analysis. We're going to focus on baseline viral load. And if I take the log of viral load and replot that histogram, you can see that that looks a whole lot nicer in terms of being able to distinguish across people. I don't know if there's a massive influence from individuals that are coming out of the 1.4 million counts for baseline viral load. Okay, so for just a second before I go on anything else, let's think a little bit about the mean model that we're interested in here so that we're all on the same page. So what's my question of interest? Tina, can I answer something?
Sorry.
No, it's okay. Did you
need
something?
No.
I'll help out.
Viral load is positive because
that is correct. That is correct. It is just a baseline viral load. Now, viral load would be changing in these people. The question is, well, actually, that's what I'm asking. Okay. What is the scientific question of interest in that patient? Does baseline viral load have an effect on the change in CD4 counts over time? About a mean model that makes sense for answering the question. Let's let Yij, I'll write this down in just a minute, but Yij is going to stand for the CD4 count measured on the ith subject at the jth time, right? Or the Tij time. So if I write down that mean model, what is beta 1?
It's the fixed effect where out Yij depends on the time.
Right. And then Yaron is going to say it's the rate of change over any subject, which is a similar way of saying this, right? This is the first order of trajectory of CD4 counts within subjects averaged over individuals. The marginal aspect of that. You guys with me on this? Just a simple slope over time for CD4 counts. Okay. So now modify, so I have now a first order slope of CD4 counts as a function of time across individuals, and our question of interest says, hey, does the baseline viral load impact the rate of change of CD4 counts across individuals? So what's a way that I can modify this model to answer that question? So now, I like the first part, which is, and in our case, I'm going to look at log viral load, okay? So I'm going to write it down here because I want to talk about the interpretation of that as well. Log viral load at time zero. So, okay, so I like that, Francis. We got viral load. That's a part of the predictor of interest in the model. So what's the other part that I need to bring in here?
Random.
I'd say anything about random anything yet. I've got a mean stuck on this thing. I got expectation sitting there. I want to just answer the scientific question first. Like, what is the mean model?
Yeah, I said intercept, but I don't. You just said
They're all right through that, so I assume. That's because I'm not saying anything about variance components here, right? And the, what do we assume about those random intercepts?
No, not, not intercept interactions.
Ah, I like that. Okay, yeah, I wouldn't have barreled through that. Okay. I like that. So what Francis is saying is, oh, okay, this is the rate of change of CD4 within the subject. And the question that we're trying to ask is whether the association between time and CD4 differs depending upon what your baseline viral load is, right? So that's that interaction. So truly, you're interested in that, right? Whether that is differing from zero or not. Everybody with me so far on just the straight, you got to first start by saying I need to be able to parameterize what I want to answer, right? And that's exactly what that question is saying to us. Okay. Yes. What's that now? Does baseline viral load have an effect on the change in CD4 counts across subjects? This is the first order change across time. Remember, an interaction says, does the association between time and CD4 counts differ depending upon that third covariate, right? So baseline viral load in this case. Is that okay? So this is just simply an easy way to say this is to say, does the slope differ depending upon what my starting viral load value is? That's what that, if this guy is zero, and the answer is no, it doesn't differ. Baseline viral load is, it's the same for everybody, regardless of what baseline viral load is. But if this guy is non-zero, then it's going to depend upon whatever that baseline viral load is. So let's go ahead, we can write it out another way. So from the model, I wanted to talk about, well, what is the linear trajectory? Linear trajectory of CD4 counts for a subject that has baseline viral load equals the little x, say. Then what is that going to be for my model? Thank you. D4. Counts among. Actually, I feel like this actually. Start off with something easy. So let's compare the baseline CD4 count, i.e. at time zero, among two subpopulations. One with viral load equal to little x, and one with viral load equal to e times little x. I did a natural log on viral load. So what I'm asking now is, what is the expectation of yij? That's going to be the first visit ultimately. At time tij equal to zero and viral load equal to little x, or e times little x, I'll start off with, minus the expectation of yij, given tij equal to zero, and viral load equal to little x. Okay, so I'm comparing those two subpopulations. You guys with me so far? Okay, I'm at time zero, viral load equal to e times little x, viral load equal to little x. So if I write that down from my mean model, this up for you guys. Here I'm gonna get a beta naught plus, well, Tij is equal to zero, I'm talking about the baseline CD4 count. Beta 2 in this case is equal to log e times little x of that subpopulation, and then my interaction goes away, so I'm trying to make this easy. So let's talk about baseline here. Minus, for this subpopulation, I'm talking about beta naught plus, oops, that should have been a beta, plus a beta 2 log little x. You guys with me? So what am I going to get back out of this? I've taken the natural log here. So those things cancel and I get back beta 2. You guys with me? Yeah? Okay.
E times x.
Yeah, it's E times x. E times x. Okay. So again, when you start log transforming predictors in your model, you have to start thinking about multiplicative effects of that predictor of interest. That's the point here if you want to get it back on the regular scale, okay? So this is, again, this is review from 211. We did this back then, okay? Now, it would probably not be so nice for you to go to somebody and say, okay, take two subpopulations differing by an e-fold increase in their log based on viral load. That pretty much takes you back to the log of viral load, right? So what might you do? Use log base 10, use log base 2, oftentimes we will use, right? So you think about a doubling of a particular value. So log base 2 is a very popular kind of approach to take in that case. If it's 10, then you got to make sure you have the range of the subpopulation that you're thinking about. Can you really get a tenfold increase across the individual? So yeah, what I will often do, a common trick that I will have, is taking, say, log base 2 there. And I can talk about doubling of particular predictors of interest and what the impact is very easily. Okay? Everybody with me on that? Okay. So now if you wanted to talk about slopes, you have to do the same thing, multiplicative changes in the underlying log mean baseline viral load at cross-up observations. I'll let you guys work on the slope interpretation here. You should be able to extrapolate this one very easily. Okay, so good. We are now, we've got a mean model that we are interested in. So I wanted to specify this first because everything we're going to do from this point on is really diagnostics for the variance covariance structure. It is the things that you guys were talking about in terms of random intercepts, random slopes, etc. But first we have to start off by saying, well, really, what do we want to answer, right? That's what we want to answer. So myself's question is, well, how do I know I want a mean effect from baseline viral load in there? That's actually not the only way. I mean, myself's question is very relevant. I can have an interaction between baseline viral load and time and not have a mean effect. Yeah.
You're assuming that it doesn't affect the C equal counts.
When?
At baseline.
Right? It's the exact thing that we just now wrote. So if I remove the mean effect for baseline viral load, what I'm doing, what I'm telling my model is I'm saying, look, there is an explicit assumption that all subjects, regardless of whatever their baseline viral load have the exact same mean CD4 count at time zero, right, where they be. And so the answer is usually the answer that comes back on almost any interaction term, which is if you're putting an interaction term in, you usually want the mean effects, because I think it would be pretty unreasonable in this case for me to assume that regardless of what other two individuals' baseline viral loads are, their CD4 count's going to be, the mean CD4 counts across those populations are going to be the same. Okay. So whenever you start thinking about an interaction term and removing potentially a mean effect, the first thing that should come to your mind are what are the restrictions that are being put on the means for the model, right? So that's the most important thing outside of this context, you know. What am I forcing to have equal in my model when I remove those mean effects? And once you write down that, usually 9 times out of 10, actually 999 times out of 1,000, you're going to say, oh, I don't really want to make those assumptions. I don't want to force particular subpopulations to have the same.
You still probably want to include more covariance, right, for confounders?
Absolutely. I'm keeping a very simplified thing right now, but sure, there are a lot of things that can confound baseline viral load and
we don't think of that as being part of our scientific.
No, it is. I'm just trying to simplify things to the primary predictor of interest, right? I will argue that interactions there is our predictor of interest for this particular question, right? It is that change. So no, that's all part of the systematic model, Stephen. So sorry if I was trying to, you took me as implying that. You really want to think about the confounding factors, right, that might come into play. You guys want to give me some that you might think of? For this particular study?
Antiretroviral.
Yeah, antiretroviral or any other med, right? I mean, there are a lot of meds out there that could be having an impact on baseline viral load status and or CD4 counts. Right? So that's other concomitant medications for sure, and antiretrovirals would definitely be one of them. I think Hina said age, sure. I mean, age is almost, you're dealing with people. Age is almost something you automatically want to start thinking, okay, yeah, better start thinking about age, how it impacts maybe viral load at baseline versus how it's impacting CD4 counts in individuals. What about whether they had pneumonia at the time they came in for the visit? Sure, right? Other comorbidities or sicknesses that they might have acutely at that moment in time. So you're going to say something.
Exercise,
absolutely, could be having an impact on how hard you hit, quote unquote, by the disease at baseline versus what the impact is on your CD4 counts in your household. So lots of things, Stephen, is what I'm getting at, so, that I really want to take into account. Okay. Good. Excellent question. All right. Okay, so now let's do a little bit more looking at the baseline viral loads for a second here. So let me just make sure I'm kind of keeping you guys up to date on where we are in the notes. So we just did our log transform. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at baseline viral load. And I'm going to divide that into categories, again, for some simple descriptive statistics to think about what is the variation as we're going across different baseline viral load categories in these responses. So all I'm doing right now, and you'll see kind of the method to the madness in just a second. So I'm going to take that log baseline viral load. I'm going to put in six different cutoffs here, kind of equally spaced, and then show you what the distribution of the log baseline viral load is in each one of those particular cutoff groups. Yeah. So now note that this wouldn't be the usual way that you might create cutoffs. If I was going to create six different groups, what I've done here is I've taken the range of my data and basically cut it into six equal parts. Okay, that's what I've done. Why do I say that's not the usual way people would create six different groups? When you take a continuous cohort and you discretize it, so first of all, why would you discretize a continuous cohort? Let me ask that. Some of you might be saying, I would never discretize a continuous cohort. So interpretability is often a primary reason why we want to discretize a continuous cohort, right? I can easily explain to somebody, here is what the mean value of CD4 counts is in group X versus group Y. Right? So that's one reason that we will often do this ourselves.
We also assume that something is like really nonlinear going on.
We also want to do it to make ourselves kind of, if you will, robust to kind of simple functional forms, right? So instead of me assuming a linear first order effect of baseline viral load or log viral load in this case, I'll create that into six categories, which puts no constraint on the functional form. Between those categories, within each category, we assume they're constant, right? It's a step function. But it allows the categories themselves to change, right? In an arbitrary fashion. So that's another reason. And so now if you're going to do it for one of those reasons, what people will most often do is to create quantiles, right? Or not in this case, it would be quantiles. If I wanted six categories, I would do it based upon their quartiles, or I'm sorry, on their quantiles size. Now, why would I do that, and why do we typically default to that?
We want to make sure there's a good number of
conditions. Why?
So that you're not getting power, extreme amounts of power on that variable.
There you go. It's for statistical efficiency, right? You want roughly a balance, quote unquote, design at that point. You want equal numbers of individuals across the groups so that you have relevant amounts of information in each one of those groups, approximately homogeneous coming through. Okay? So that's the way we would most normally do this. Now, the first reason I would say the best reason is if you're going to create a discretized variable, if you have scientific rationale for doing it, do it based upon that. If you don't have scientific rationale for doing it, you probably want to do it based upon having kind of equal numbers of individuals within each group, because that kind of comes back to statistical efficiency. What I'm doing here is just to give you guys an example, and part of it that I want to do is I want to show kind of what the individuals that are really on the tails of the distribution for log baseline viral load are looking like. Okay. So this is not going to ultimately be my predictor of interest at the end of the day, but I'm doing it really for descriptive reasons to kind of highlight those individuals that are really low on log viral load category or really high. Again, what I've got now, these are unequal groups in terms of numbers of individuals that are coming up here, and then these are just simply the means, and then the 25th, 50th, and 75th percentiles of those groups, so that you can see kind of how things are changing on the medians, and how things are changing on the first and last quartile of the distributions. Okay. interested in is saying, does the baseline viral load impact the rate of change in CD4 counts across subjects? And so what I want to do now is I want to produce for you guys a descriptive plot, and this is what I would do for somebody, showing what the observed trajectories are among individuals as I change from their log baseline viral load patterns. So I've just described, if you will, the distribution of the log baseline viral load categories, but now I want a way of doing this where I can illustrate what the trajectories are looking like. Okay. So to do that, this is a little new for most of you guys. So I'm going to read in the NLME library. It stands for Nonlinear Mixed Effects Models. Okay. So this is author Pinero and Bates. And they have a textbook that actually goes along with this package, but you're getting most of that actually coming from the class that we'll meet. So I'm taking my log baseline viral load category that I just created. That's 1 through 6, okay? There's 6 different groups that I have there. And I'm going to create, or I'm going to turn it into a factored variable, okay? So I'm just creating it and making it a factor here so that R will recognize it. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another data set called group, max group. And this is really in the context of the NLME package, okay? So what I'm doing is I'm defining a structure in the data set. And the structure that I'm defining is saying, look, I'm primarily interested in the rate of change of CD4 as a function of time. This bar here says that there is clustering in my data set, and the clustering occurs at the individual level. And so the clusters are defined by the IDs that I have in the data set. And then the outer is simply going to be, that's the thing that I often will compare across, okay, if you're trying to read this and put this into words. So when I'm thinking about the relationship between CD4 and time, the thing that I generally want to compare across individuals is the log baseline viral load category as I'm coming forward. And so you feed in your regular data. Again, this just simply defines the structure that you are interested in scientifically. And then the labels are just going to be nice in terms of the plot, and we'll see that in just a minute. Okay. So the labels meaning that I'm going to label this guy a month, and I'll label the response that's sitting over here, CD4 count. So now one of the nice things about this is that when I do a plot and I've defined that structure, now that it's built that structure in, right? So what's happened is it said, okay, I'm really interested in CD4 count as a function of time. The clustering unit is on the ID. Those are the different spaghetti plots that you're getting there. And the thing that I'm running around out, or that I'm interested in comparing across these things, is the baseline viral load category. Okay? So this is the lowest, or sorry, this is the highest category here, down to lowest top. And so a couple of things about this. So what do you observe from this? So this is now basically a stratified spaghetti plot, right, relative to the scientific question of interest. But what are the observations that we might take away from this? Well, is it Sasha? Sorry. You have a lot of observations in the middle. That's the unbalancedness in the way I created those groups, right? Because I just kind of divided this thing by 6. And so again, that was kind of highlighting for you the fact that I probably get sparseness on these other two sides as I'm going through. What else? Is greater when the log viral load is large at baseline. So tell me where we're pointing that. So what, take it back to the scientific question of interest, right? I mean, what does your eye tell you about the scientific question of interest? What are you asking?
Well, yeah, I'm just trying to visualize it. Probably we're interested in whether, like, the initial points really correspond to the points on the right.
Right, but I've already kind of stratified out by the initial points, right? That's what the definition of my six groups are individuals that tend to have higher versus lower baseline violent loan categories. And so now, if you imagine kind of, I know it's difficult, but if you imagine kind of marginalizing and drawing a slope here, right? Marginalizing and drawing a slope here, then what is my scientific question of interest? Whether those slopes are differing as I'm going across these different categories, right? Okay. I mean, that's the first thing you kind of want to start really looking at in this plot. So, is there strong evidence that suggests that that might be happening?
No.
There really isn't, okay? At least I can't see it. And it's hard to read. I mean, I'll agree that it's hard to read, particularly in the middle categories where you have lots of individuals there. But, you know, everybody's kind of got a negative slope kind of coming down, and there's really not a huge amount of variability if you kind of marginally across these things. And what I mean by that is I'm saying relatively. I don't have groups where I have kind of a constant slope in some groups and some groups where it's really coming down. Everybody's kind of got this gradual decline over time. So we're going to see, though, I mean, this obviously is a very crude analysis of that, crude descriptive analysis, because I've kind of divided my groups up in these ways. But now, what else can I glean from this, though? Now, thinking about kind of the focus of our class and variance, covariance, matrices, and things like that, and diagnostics for EDA. Random intercepts, right? Huge random intercepts. In other words, if you take time zero, there's massive heterogeneity in people, right? That's going across here. So that should already be telling you, yeah, probably random intercepts are going to come up in this analysis for sure. Yeah. Trajectories. I'll admit, Sasha, very hard for me to tell on trajectories on something like this. And the reason why is because my eye isn't very good at kind of picking up when I've got so many of these different spaghetti plots of what's going on in terms of whether they're truly random or not. And some people would claim that, yeah, there are definitely random trajectories there. It's much harder for me to see. I mean, again, I can look at the case study. I can look at this person in green here that's coming down and this person in yellow here and say, they're clearly different. But as I think aggregately across the populations, it's harder for me to see. Okay? And could I tell the difference between, say, a random slope type of structure and a serial correlation structure from this? No. And I think you guys are seeing that on your homeworks right now. When you simulate those two things up, it's very hard to tell which one of those you're talking about, right? Like if it's an AR1 process or if it's a serial, if it's a random slope type of process. But the one thing that I do have going for me here from this plot is definitely correlation within the subject, at minimum manifesting from random intercepts. Some individuals are tending to be high, some individuals tend to be low. There's lots of variation here. People are definitely not starting off in the same place. Okay? So far, so good? So let's go.
Then we should be able to differentiate between, say, something that has a random intercept and something that has a random intercept and then we can go just by looking at the
spaghetti plot. Not necessarily. Again, you know, I mean, you're looking at some examples where I've given you some where it's kind of gross, right? And you can kind of see it. You can see things fan out when you simulate data on the whole. On something like this, again, you know, I have a very hard time picking up random slopes in this type of plot. Practice that, I'm just being honest. It's hard for me visually to look at that and go, yeah, I've clearly got random slopes going on here. People are kind of jumping all around and it's hard for me to tell. And part of that is I haven't taken out any of the systematic component of any other covariance. Okay. Yeah.
Should we consider like, this kind of thing data driven model?
No, this is descriptive analysis, right? This is
exploratory between.
But I'm still trying to consistently estimate the same quantity, which is beta through the zone. trying to do it as efficient as possible. So normally when we talk about data-driven modeling, we really talk about, you know, well, maybe, you know, maybe it wasn't that subpopulation, maybe it was just individuals that were on antiretrovirals or something, you know, changing that underlying model in terms of what we're trying to estimate and answer. Okay? Now, you are going to see something. There is an aspect here, and there is a flirtation with doing this, where individuals will say, well, what I'll do is I'll try 9 different working covariate structures and see if my quote-unquote p-value changes at the end of the day for my, that would be the issue of modeling, right? I mean, now you're kind of, you're saying, let me go and try and find an optimal weight. It gives me optimal being, gives me the smallest p-value of these things. I wouldn't suggest doing that. What I'm really trying to do is saying, if I just take a descriptive analysis here, I want just a reasonable assumption of what the working covariate structure is. Yeah, so.
I want to ask my question again. First about the main set.
Yes.
So if you have this and you have the random set, where do you place it? Do you place it for the combination of beta 0 plus beta 2 and
random intercept? Well, okay, so the random intercept. Paraphrase just a little bit, Francis, but I like the general idea here. So it's the mean CD4 count at the time of zero conversion. And just to make that explicit, what I mean by that is IETIJ equaling zero. Interpretable? actually not, right? I mean, everyone of these guys has a viral load way above me. I mean, there's nobody who did it close to that. Okay, so now if you wanted to make this interpretable, what might you do? Mean center might be something I might do. On the viral loads, you could mean center and then take the log of them, for example. Okay, or you might take the median viral load and kind of center it at that, right? Because they're highly skewed, because of what the viral loads are. And then you'd be talking about, okay, what is the mean CD4 count at baseline among individuals that have either the average or the median live viral load count at the time of zero conversion? So far so good for everybody? Okay. Let me write one other thing up here that we generally make an assumption here, which is E0 being died, equaling zero, right? That guy's forced down to zero. In other words, there's a population mean, and then there's random deviation across the ith individuals. Are we starting to get to where we're at now? Okay, so I don't want to pull out the viral load, and I don't want to force this thing into the viral load intercept here. What I'm doing is I'm saying there's a population mean that's out there, which is your underlying CD4 count at the time of zero conversion. And then how much are individuals varying or differing around that population mean? Do individuals tend to be super high or tend to be low? You guys with me? So if I were thinking about a random intercept type of model, this is the structure it would take. Where now this thing you can think about is combining up with this for the ith individual. It's the population plus my deviation from the population. You guys with me on that? Okay. Okay. So from the in the context of what we're doing right now, which is an EDA, if you were going to stick to this model, what does your variance covariance structure look like on the responses at the end of the day? You guys have been working with this enough on homework now. It's compound symmetric, right? It looks like sigma squared plus tau squared on the diagonal, and then covariance of tau squared, right? Good. So far, so good. Okay. So is that okay, Monty Sloan, in terms of the answer and how we're going to incorporate it and what it's going to, what the meaning is? But again, as I take the expectation of this thing all the way through, just going back to Arnie's point a minute ago, my systematic component is not changing. Okay? And I'm trying to answer that question of beta 3 being 0 or not. Okay? I'm right now doing some diagnostics to say, is it likely that this thing is bigger than 0? Right? That's what we're seeing in that scatter plot. So now let's do a little bit more. Again, it's hard for me to read. This is going back to the questions before. Hard for me to read kind of random slopes and then serial autocorrelation. So I find it a little bit easier to start looking at things like empirical correlation matrices to try and diagnose autocorrelation through time, and then ultimately the variogram, which is what we're going to do as well. So similar to last time, what I want to do is I want to take out in some flexible way the effect of time, okay? So I want to mean center my responses, CD4 in this case, to create residuals. So I'm going to fit a model where I have this very flexible functional form for time, and I'll create the residuals that come from that model, okay? So now I'm just taking CD4, subtracting off their fitted means from that natural smoother. And then this is just the exact same code that I had last time, but now tailored towards this problem where I'm going to create a quote-unquote residual matrix and then turn those residuals into moment-based estimates of the variance and then the correlation as I'm going through time. So I'm dividing time up here into 8 components. Okay. So at the end of the day, again, on the top there, what I got is the empirical correlation matrix. Again, that's taking pairwise, if you will, correlation estimates, moment-based correlation estimates between observations. And when I present something like that, I always present it down with a matrix basically of sample sizes. How many observations am I using to compute those pairwise estimates on? Okay. So this is a slight, a much, in fact, different problem than what you guys had last time where we looked at the full max data set. Remember there, because there was all these staggerings of times around individuals, we had some individuals that were going way out with 13 measurements where there were only like two or three of them, okay? And we were trying to estimate correlations. Here I've got plenty of information as I'm going out from, say, all the way to month 45 or 45 months post zero conversion on individuals to be able to estimate these parameters, okay? Now, why is it lower at month 15? That's because some individuals didn't come back. So I divided the data set up, and a lot of individuals didn't come back between, say, 10 months and 20 months. So you can see kind of where individuals are falling here as I divided through time. So now, from the empirical correlation, what do you see? It's definitely falling, right? In other words, as I'm one step off, so I'm like 10 months out from a previous measurement, then I've got really high correlation. I've got correlation estimates that are around 0.86, 0.8, 0.75, 0.61. Okay? And as I jump out now to 20 months, it goes down to 0.63, 25 months, 0.62, 0.6, 0.59, etc. So there's some aspect of serial or autocorrelation going on. Okay? What else do you take home from this? Does it look like that serial autocorrelation is going to zero over the course of your follow-up? No. Which means that there is this residual correlation. So if you think back about the variogram, what would that imply to us? It's gonna threshold well below the total variance, right? Because there's this continuous autocorrelation still going on in the data, at least over our course of follow-up. Maybe if I would have followed these people up to 300 months out, that might have gone to zero. I don't know, but for the course of follow-up that I have on them, I've definitely still got correlation that's going on, even 45 months out. Okay? So that's indicative of saying you better start including at least a random intercept in the log that's there, and you might want to also have some serial process that's going on as well. Okay? Yep. So now let's go ahead and look at the variogram and see if that matches what we had observed in the empirical correlation. So again, similar code to what I had last time. I'm just using the lva.variogram function again that I used last time. Run that through and print it. And what do you see? What's that represent? Excellent. So what Francis said was, I'm going to rephrase the form just slightly, instantaneous measurement error, right? As two observations close in on time at the same moment of time, but I still have variance in those observations. They're not perfectly correlated. What about in terms of the smoother that I have running across the top? This is telling me that I've got a serial process that's decaying somewhat. It's not a huge component of variation. If you think about from here up the sill in terms of the total variation of my data, it's not a massive component of it, but it's there. And you can see that actually in the empirical correlation estimate. And then the fact that we're starting to taper off here, that's that random intercept. That's that correlation of about 0.45, 0.5 that's still existing at 45 months out. You guys with me? Okay. Good. All right. So now, let me just make sure that we're all on the same page. We've got a reasonable assessment now of what's going on in the data in terms of random intercepts, yes, some serial process, yes, and then measurement error for sure as well. So now, let's do just a little bit more empirical work on random effects. So in other words, random slopes, and then maybe, or sorry, random intercepts, and then maybe random slopes like Sasha was bringing up before. This is a way for me to better visualize random intercepts and random slopes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to think about each individual sampling unit and think about just fitting a line to that individual. Nothing wrong with that, right? I mean, if you didn't know anything about this class, you hadn't taken it before, and somebody said, hey, look, I want you to go and see whether the slopes are different comparing patients that have high or low baseline viral load categories. One of the things you might naturally do is say, I'm going to take each individual, I'm going to estimate a slope for them, that's going to become my response, and I'll compare those responses across log baseline viral load categories. That seem reasonable? I think that's what you would do, right? You'd be back down to independent data. You now have a slope estimate for each person, and you can compare them across their baseline viral load category. Yeah? What are the issues in doing that?
You say it's like 4 or 5 observations for like
5 eight, or yeah. So Nina's getting at one issue of doing that. She's saying, well, if I've got some individuals that only have 3 observations and I go and I estimate a slope on them, that's going to be a highly variable slope estimate, right? Response measure. Okay. So that's one issue. You're not borrowing any information. Just taking that person's 3 observations. The next issue, though, is when I do that, and I then, say, regress those estimated slopes, those individual estimated slopes on baseline viral load category, am I giving equal weight to every subject? If I do OLS? Sure, if I do OLS, I'm saying each one of these things get equal weight to my analysis. Does it make sense that you would want to give the same amount of weight to the subject that has 3 CD4 measurements to a subject that has 9 CD4 measurements? Who do you have a better estimate of the slope on? Person with 9, right? So you probably want to upweight it. That's what you're really doing with the longitudinal data analysis here. That's what the variance-covariance matrix is actually doing for you. It's accounting for the fact that you've got these repeated measures on people, and they're varying across individuals. Okay. So, but fitting the individual level slopes can be useful for diagnostics, and that's what I'm going to do here, because what I can do is I can say, well, if I just take my individual level data, I have an estimate of each person's intercept, and I have an estimate of each person's slope, and I can see how much they're varying around. That seem reasonable? That's going to get me at this concept of, do I have random intercepts or random slopes in my data? Okay. So as a diagnostic, I'm going to go through and assess that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to fit individual OLS models for each person, where I'm just simply regressing CD4 on month for right now. Okay. Now, you could run through and do a loop where you apply LM, but you can use a handy function inside of the NLME package called LMList, because people want to do this so often, where basically what this will do is take our group data. Remember, I already told it that it was clustered by ID. Okay. So for every ID, it's going to go ahead and fit that model. Okay. Come back with an OLS estimate there. So if you just simply now take that output and look at the coefficients from it, and come back up here, then what you have is for each subject that I have in my data set, so here's subject 7301, I have an estimated intercept from an OLS model and I have an estimated slope from that OLS model. Okay, so that's what that LMList function is doing. The other nice thing is because we just now talked about this variance, because some people have 3 measurements, some people have 9 measurements, that you can get intervals from those subjects as well. So now if I do intervals of that object, what I will get back, I'll look at the slopes for just a second, as an example. So for the month covariate, I will get back my estimate of the slope. That's what you saw just a minute ago for this person, 7301. But then I'll also get a 95% confidence interval on that slope, right? Because I know that there's variation in these things. Okay. And so a plot that I find useful for trying to diagnose random intercepts and random slopes is to say, okay, let's take that LM list, and there's actually a plot intervals function, right? And so now that's each individual that's sitting over there on the left. And you guys' notes, by the way, I've just subsampled 25 individuals so you can actually read them. But this is everybody in the data set. These are each individual that designates a row. And then what you're seeing here are the intercepts on individuals. and then you're seeing the slope on individuals. So why are they clustered like that right now? It's because I created that log viral load category and I put it as outer inside of my, when I define the max grouping. So it's inherently clustering individuals by that baseline category, the six categories. That's the groups that you're seeing there, okay? That's why you're seeing them. Now, if I did not have random intercepts in my data, what would I expect to see? I would expect to see basically a line. These things are just scattering up and down a line, right? Very little variation in those things. But what you're seeing are some individuals, even with their uncertainty estimates, way up here. Some individuals with their uncertainty estimates way over here, which is indicating to you, again, random intercepts. Okay. And what about random slopes? It's a whole lot harder to tell there. There's a lot of overlap there. I mean, there are some individuals that are kind of floating around, but that's not as clear of a sign of random. And that's what I was saying from the spaghetti plot either. I mean, it's not obvious random slopes to me from looking at that plot there. There's quite a bit of overlap that's floating around. Again, there are some individuals that are outlined, but it's not like that amount of variation that you're seeing over on the random intercept side. Okay? But I do find this to be a pretty useful plot for trying to explain to somebody just what random intercepts and random slopes are, right? Kind of, these are the individual level estimates of what you have. Okay. Good. So now, and again, a useful thing that I would probably do for individuals rather than give them all of those data, maybe in an appendix or something like that, is just subsample, maybe a few individuals like you have in your notes so you can kind of get an idea of what's happening. So now let's further investigate, since we've got these individual level slopes, let's further just kind of as a descriptive analysis investigate whether there might be an impact of log baseline viral load on individuals. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take off each individual's individual level slope estimate from an OOS model, I'll call that beta 1, and then I'm just simply going to create a box plot by the six different categories that I had before. Again, these are all things that I would consider to be good descriptive statistics for this particular analysis, right? I'm trying to investigate whether those slopes are really different across log baseline viral load category, and this is what you see. So tell me what you find here. Those are the box plots of distributions of slopes across individuals. Yeah, and how many people are in that sixth quantile? You saw it in the spaghetti plots, there's like seven or something.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's about seven lines that you saw there. So there's not a whole lot of heterogeneity going on right over here. And then you get that last category and it starts to drop off and it says, yeah, people that are kind of way up inside of their viral load categories, in other words, have the highest baseline viral load categories, do have kind of a steep drop in the CD4 counts. But the other five groups, not totally different. Or at least it's hard to tell a pattern there. There's a little bit of kind of maybe downward trend going on, but not much. So another thing that I might do is take those slopes and then simply run a smoother through them and plot them against the log baseline viral load. And so this is a plot where, again, I have the individual level estimates of the slopes over time. All this is descriptive statistics. I have the log baseline viral load category, and again, the underlying hypothesis here is that as log baseline viral load category increases, the slopes start getting smaller. And so what do you see from the smoother? Similar picture to what we had before, right? As you get to these few individuals that are sitting out here in the top category, they start to drop pretty heavily, so they're really influencing that smoother coming down. As you start thinking about where most individuals lie with respect to their viral load counts, they're kind of sitting here flat. And then you get influences coming over here from individuals that tend to be very low in their log baseline viral load categories. You guys with me on this so far? Again, all I've created is a simple summary measure of the first order rate of change for each subject. And I'm just assessing that now in a univariate context like you guys have done through 210. Okay.
Dan?
Yeah.
Is there like an expected survival time after seroconversion?
Yes, I don't know what it is. I mean, there is a mean. I don't know exactly what it is, but it wouldn't be, there's not that much, if you look at the data, there's not that much censoring due to deaths, actually.
Okay.
That's the underlying question,
yeah.
Which I think is, and it's a good one. But over the 45 months that we have, basically roughly 4 years, there's not a ton of deaths that have occurred in the data set. So, okay. Now, you might be worried about some individuals that are coming away down here, right? That's
right.
Probably your concern. It doesn't turn out to be that much of a problem. Over the 45 months. Good. Yes?
The flatness isn't a maybe you don't have random slopes, but it doesn't matter where that flatness is.
Okay, so careful though, I wanna make a point here. This isn't really speaking to me necessarily about random slopes. So the overall variation here kind of speaks to random slopes, right? That's how much variation there are in slopes. But this smoother that's running through here is a function of the quote-unquote predictor of interest, right? The viral load category. So the flatness that I see there, if this solid line were totally flat, right? So it was just sitting there with a slope of zero, then what would that imply to me about my question of interest? It would say that the slope, the individual level slope for each person, does not change depending upon what their baseline viral load is. Right, so that's really what I'm trying to assess here. I'm trying to get a simple descriptive to just glean some information regarding the thing that we're interested in here. If this thing had a solid line that went straight down, that would say, oh yeah, as your baseline viral load category is going up, your trajectories are going down relative to everybody. Okay? So I think what we're seeing here is the people that have really, really high baseline viral load categories, they tend to have a very steep decline in their CD4 counts. And the people that have very, very low category as well, their CD4 counts are kind of normal. Okay? In other words, they're stable. They're not declining too much. But everybody else in the middle, there's not a lot of variation in their individual level slope depending upon their viral load category that they start with. That's what this is telling me. Is that okay, Scott? Okay. All right, I didn't get a chance to get to model fitting, which is part of your guys' homework. all right,
so close.
Let's do this. Homework will be delayed until Wednesday. You guys can basically do everything up to literally fitting one model, which will take you like 10 seconds, okay? But I want to go over it in discussion tomorrow, okay? So, do all the EDA covariants on your homework. You can have that done, but we'll delay the due date on homework until Wednesday, and tomorrow what I will do is finish off this example and then we can talk a little bit about other things. But your homework is not due.